Right, I'm joined by Louis Passfield, Professor of Sports Science. Louis dropped by to help us out with a video that we've done over on GCN about cadence when climbing. And we thought that given that we're allowed to geek out here on the Tech Channel, that we would do just that. So Louis, got your science hat on, as always, in fact. Let's go for it. First question for you, what is an optimal cadence? We were talking about it at length on GCN, but let's go into the science of it. What is an optimal cadence?
That's a great question, Simon, and I'm glad we're now on the Geeky channel,
because there we go.
If we weren't, I would have to give you a number, but instead I can say, well, it depends.
Oh, God.
And the main thing actually that affects optimal cadence is how hard you're working.
Okay.
So an optimal cadence when you're not working very hard, can be a little lower than it is when you're working hard.
Okay.
So the higher the intensity of exercise, the higher your optimal cadence becomes.
Okay, and why is that?
There's probably a number of factors. Two of the key ones are your physiological makeup.
Okay.
So if you're a fast twitch person, then that will shift where your optimal cadence occurs compared with a slow twitch person.
Okay.
And as implied by the names of the muscle fiber types, a slow twitch person is probably going to have a lower optimal cadence than a fast twitch person. So part of it is down to your own genetics and how you're put together.
Okay.
And the consequences of the training that you've done too. The other reason is because in order to work harder, you're producing more force on the pedals. And so as the force increases and the power increases, the optimal cadence for that force production also goes up too.
Okay.
So your power is a combination of force and cadence. And as we all know, when you're working really hard, you can sustain that power output in two ways. You can pedal very slowly and really push hard on the pedal, so high forces, or you can reach the same power output by pedaling a little bit faster in a lower gear or an easier gear and spinning a bit more, still working really hard, but you've lowered the force and increased the cadence instead.
Yeah.
Now, the higher that power output is, the more you're working, the more the balance shifts towards a higher cadence and a lower force in order to try and keep things under control. Because those high forces are really difficult for the muscles to generate, and they produce a lot of fatigue too. So as the demand for power goes up, the force goes up, and to try and mitigate against that a little bit, you increase the cadence too.
Yeah, so as a question to start then, it's a bit of a Pandora's box. So optimal cadence will vary for a given rider, depending on how much power they're putting out.
And it will depend— muscle fiber type.
Yeah, and so it will depend from rider to rider as to what an optimal cadence is. So that whole pedal at 90 RPM as an optimal cadence, you know, that's got a bit of scientific grounding, but broadly speaking, it's meaningless from rider to rider.
Well, it's a great starting point, and I think you can't ignore the importance of empirical or experience in these things. And there's a really good reason why a lot of experienced riders pedal at those kind of cadences, even if we can't always explain it perfectly scientifically. But if you were to put someone in a lab and do the most obvious experiment, which is to say, where is your heart rate lowest? Where is your energy expenditure lowest? It would be at a really low cadence if you're not working very hard. It would be down around 60 revs per minute, the kind of cadence that no one would normally consider pedaling at if they're an experienced cyclist out on the road or riding their bikes competitively. As the workload increases, then even in the laboratory, those optimal cadences rise slightly. They just don't seem to reflect what cyclists actually do. So there are other factors at play, not just how efficient or economical you are.
And could you guess at what those factors are?
Well, we get some insight if we just look at typically what people do. So as one of the things we were thinking about is what happens in different events.
Yeah.
And we could compare what looks like the optimal cadence for an hour record compared with, for example, a 4 kilometer pursuit on the track or a sprint on the track.
Yeah.
And you can see that playing out there, because the optimal cadence for an hour record is considerably lower than it is for a 4 kilometer effort, which is considerably lower than it is for a sprint.
And then if you extrapolate that out and say someone that's doing a 24 hour record, would they therefore be pedaling slower still, you think?
Oh, that's—
or is that when you bring in, you know, muscle fiber, like, what's the word? Fatigue, that's what I was thinking. So fatigue, obviously you get more fatigue if you're pedaling slower, presumably, so you might be more efficient, but you're doing more muscle damage.
Fancy you stumbling over fatigue.
It's because I'm fatigued.
Broadly, that's one of the things we think is happening with cyclists pedaling faster, is it lowers their perception of effort, and perception of effort is really important in terms of dictating how fatigued you feel. Because in a sense, they're closely related.
Yeah.
So the more fatigued you are, the higher your perception of effort is. So if you do something that has a lower perception of effort, it will also help you feel less fatigued too. So we think one of the things that affects the cadence you pick is your perception of effort and how easy it is to pedal. And we find it easier to pedal at higher cadences compared to lower cadences and grinding away.
Except when climbing. So this is what we touched on over on GCN, is that a rider's preferred pedaling cadence does tend to decrease when climbing. Not always, there are exceptions like Froome at the Giro this year. And so one of those suggestions as to why that's the case was the effect of gravity and how that changes the forces acting on the bike. So does that change your perception of effort as well, would you think? Because most people tend to find they can put out more power when climbing.
Yes, and this is a really interesting one, because the anecdotal evidence from riders is that often they feel they can produce more power on a climb compared with on the flat. So if you ask someone to do a 5-minute time trial and do as much work as they possibly can and measure their power output over that, you typically find riders would prefer to make that effort going uphill than on the flat. They feel they can perform better in that way. So there's a suggestion that something about our pedaling technique when we go uphill enables us to produce more power. But the evidence for that scientifically is not entirely unequivocal. We did a study at the University of Kent where we compared both in and out of the saddle. We looked at economy and at different gradients too. And what we found is actually the picture is a little complicated in that it depends how hard you're working as to what the answer is. So at easy cadences, at easy efforts, out of the saddle is not as economic or as efficient. So it's kind of what you might expect or intuit.
Yeah.
The cost of standing up on the pedals when you're not working too hard means that it's less efficient to stand up than it is to sit down.
Okay.
But as you work harder, then you're benefiting from being able to bring your body weight into play, and then the difference is diminished. So there's no difference between standing up or sitting down when you're working at, say, race pace. It's only when you're pedaling easily. So if you're going easily up a climb, you can sit and pedal easily and you can benefit from the most economical effort. But once you push it and you're going as hard as you possibly can, whether you're in the saddle or out the saddle makes less difference, because now you're really trying to produce a big effort and you can employ your body weight effectively when you're out of the saddle, which means that there's no difference between those two. So I think what we find is that riders then either have a preferred climbing style, which is to mix up in and out of the saddle, in which case they'll pedal more slowly, or to sit and save their legs and spin. But then they probably won't get out of the saddle at all in those cases, but they can then learn to sustain a higher power output, a higher cadence over a period of time.
Okay, so that's the interesting point, isn't it? The picture about cadence is complicated. But I suppose what a rider would want to know, and I want to know, is if I train to pedal at a different cadence, can I change what is optimal, and would there be a more optimal cadence than the one that my body's naturally ended up with?
Uh-huh. So I think the best way of breaking this down is to say that there are two key factors to think about. The first one is what you're like as a person. What's your fibre type like? Now, we don't know the answer to that, and we don't know what the optimal is for any given person.
Given my sprint, I suspect mine's pretty slow, Lou.
Exactly. So the thing is, you're naturally perhaps slightly lower cadence than someone who's more of a sprinter.
Yeah.
And now, that's something you should accept from the start. It doesn't matter what else you do, you're always likely to pedal a little bit more slowly than that other guy or girl.
Okay.
Once you've established that everybody is slightly different, that's fine. Now you can think about what difference your training makes.
Okay.
And there you can probably make a difference over a time by deliberately training your body to be more comfortable producing power at higher cadences.
Okay.
And there may be some benefit to doing that, particularly in terms of reducing your fatigue. So you might not see it necessarily in that you perform better and go faster, but that in making that effort, you don't pay such a high cost for that one, and you can then do the same thing again and again and again, particularly, for example, in stage races or something like that, where you have to recover at the end of the day and then get up the next day and perform at just the same level again.
Okay, that's interesting. So now my training these days, if you can call it that, is unstructured, but if I was going to do cadence work, and I do sometimes just to kind of break the commute up, I will always go and choose lower cadence work. So I would always do overgeared work, but actually would I potentially be better off doing faster cadence work on my way home instead?
Well, of course, the answer there is that the lower cadence work does a different job to the high cadence work.
So I need to do both?
So, exactly.
Okay.
So the lower cadence work is improving your ability to generate high forces on the pedal. So it's like on the bike strength training.
Yeah.
But that's not going to translate into a power output unless you can combine it with a cadence too.
Okay.
being able to pedal at a higher cadence, you have to practice that separately.
Okay.
Yeah, and they would be completely different sessions as well, so don't mix them up.
No.
Do your high cadence stuff on a different day to your low cadence,
okay.
Big gear stuff.
Need to write that down. Now, last thing then, what about equipment? So when, if you analyze your own riding style and, you know, your own training data, you could probably start to work out what your optimal cadence is. I know work that you've done in the past actually does precisely that, doesn't it? Could you then look at your bike objectively and say, well, my natural preferred pedaling cadence is, let's say, it's 80 RPM, so it's on the slow side. Would running longer cranks help that? Because obviously you're increasing the leverage, but you know, you're propelling the pedals with a slower velocity, aren't you? Whereas, the reason I was thinking about this is because Emma rides super short cranks. She's on 165s, so it always looks like she's pedaling a super fast cadence, but actually, in terms of revs per minute, it's not that much faster. So can you actually use the data to help yourself in other ways as well?
Well, the research on this is fairly clear cut, actually. And one of the experts in this area is Jim Martin in the US. And he's done quite a few studies playing around with crank lengths. You call 165 super short? He's gone down to 130, 120,
even
100 mil cranks. So really little cranks.
Yeah.
And surprisingly, he says, it makes no difference.
Really?
Absolutely. So the debate about crank length and optimal crank lengths, I think there's a comfort level for different riders. And I know that if I ride 175s, being a little shorter than average, I'm normal, average.
Okay, good.
Then 175s feel a little bit long for me.
Right.
But it's purely a comfort thing. In terms of what the most effective is, it's whatever you feel comfortable with.
So even, you know, obviously from a bike fit perspective, there is a definite advantage to having crank lengths to suit your height. But there's no physiological benefit to, if you've got slow twitch muscle fibers, then a longer crank would be better because you push the pedals slower, but with higher force.
That's correct.
Okay.
No. So it doesn't. The crank length doesn't really make a huge difference. It's all about comfort, really, what you feel most comfortable with.
Okay. Someone should probably tell Adam Hansen he's using 190s, I think, still at the Giro. And what about then Q-rings? So non-round chainrings. They obviously affect your power output per every pedal stroke. The data behind that?
It's pretty ambiguous, actually. There are a couple of studies that suggest it might make a difference, but they're far from clear cut. And there are equally, those studies are matched evenly by studies that find no difference whatsoever. Just one important point to keep in mind is that it's not your power that's varying with a Q-ring. Effectively, what you're doing is the equivalent of changing gear.
So it's your cadence that would effectively be changing.
That's right. So what it's doing is it's as you move through the top and bottom dead center, you're changing gear for that little bit and then changing back to the other gear for the other part.
Okay.
So what's happening is your body is learning to compensate for the fact your gear is changing every rev. I think, again, it's one of those comfort things. If that then suits your style and you find that this is a way in which you feel more comfortable or less fatigued or you feel more powerful, then that's great. But I don't think it's actually really changing the power that you produce in each pedal per se. Rather, you're changing your power because the gear is changing.
Yeah, okay, interesting. It's a fascinating topic, isn't it? And it does feel like, although we know an awful lot about it, you know an awful lot about this, there's still an awful lot to learn. So do you think over the next few years, decades, whatever, that there will become some kind of like hard science about pedaling rate and things like that? Or is it destined to be slightly, you know, misty?
Well, when I first started studying the science of cycling, I very naively thought that the pedaling cycle, pedaling in circles would be one of the easier bits to understand.
Right.
Because your feet are tied to the pedals, you can't move those, your saddle is fixed, and really it should be a really simple action. What could be more easy? With walking, you can choose where you want to put your feet, but in cycling it's already constrained.
Yeah.
What's amazing is the more research I've done, the more complicated it's got, and I actually realise I know less and less. So I think for sure we will understand more about it, but what I've realised is it is surprisingly complicated, and you only need a few variables, which you've got in pedaling, and suddenly the picture of the different things you can change starts to get increasingly complicated. So if you only had to think about where your foot was on the pedal, that would just be one thing. But now you have to think about how long are your cranks, what's the optimal cadence, how hard are you working, what's the nature of the gradient you're on? And suddenly you can see there's a multiplicity of different factors going on. You can't possibly keep track of all of those things at once.
Yeah.
So I think there's an awful lot of work still to be done in this. But over a period of time, we'll begin to understand this more completely from a scientific perspective.
Fantastic. Great stuff. Louis, thank you very much, as ever. Absolutely fascinating. I hope you've enjoyed it as well. Give it a big thumbs up if you have. And if you want to go over to GCN, check out that video about cadence when climbing, where Louis, again, lending us his expert knowledge at the end. Make sure you check that one out. It's just over there.